Hi, it's Lachlan here, and welcome to the first episode of Audiophile, a series of videos that explains various technical aspects of audio and music. Now, for this first video, I wanted to focus on audio bit depths and 24-bit audio because of a conversation I was having with a friend about 16-bit audio, 24-bit audio, and signal-to-noise ratios. There is a widely held misperception among audiophiles that 24-bit audio relates to the resolution of an audio file. It doesn't, and this video explains why. Now, this is somewhat complex, but I promise you that if you watch this, it will save you time and money next time someone tries to sell you a 24-bit audio player. I didn't understand this stuff for a while, and it took me some reading and research. I've linked all the resources I've looked at in the description of this video. So if you want to get a more in-depth explanation of the stuff I'm going to talk about in this video, then go ahead and follow the links. So this video will cover three questions. Number one, what is audio bit depth? Number two, what does a higher bit depth mean? And number three, why is 24-bit audio a pointless waste of time? So number one, what is audio bit depth? So as we know, sound comes in a wave. If we want to record this continuous wave digitally, we record it as a certain number of samples per second. The number of samples per second is called the sampling rate, but we will talk about this in another video. So let's draw a digital signal. Note that in the past, I drew a digital signal like this, a stair-stepped wave. Let's get this misconception out of the way first. Depicting digital audio waveforms as stair steps is incorrect and misleading, and is one of the main reasons why the 24-bit audio myth has been propagated. For a complete explanation of why representing a digital audio wave as a stair step is wrong, I recommend you watch ziff.org's excellent and entertaining video presentation, but for now, I will just say this. It is more accurate to depict the way digital audio works by drawing it as a series of lollipops. We have a number of discrete individual samples, and at each sample, we have an audio level. When the digital to analog converter reconstructs the audio wave from these individual samples, it creates a smooth wave. There is no aliasing or stair-stepping in the final output. The output is always smooth because the digital analog converter creates a line that passes through all sample points. So then what is a bit depth? To answer that, let's go back to our wave. When we sample our wave, we need to assign a level to each sample that best represents the original waveform. We need to give each sample a value. Computers represent values in bits. The word bit is a portmanteau of binary digit, i.e. 1 and 0. So when we say bit depth, we are saying how many bits we are using to describe the different levels of one audio sample. So let's say we have a bit depth of 1. This means that we can assign two levels to a waveform, 0 and 1. So we end up with this. Let's say we have a bit depth of 2. This means that we can have four possible combinations, 00, 01, 10, and 11. When we get up to 16-bit audio, we have 65,536 possible values to describe the audio level. So you may have noticed that when we assign these values to the samples, we are rounding up or down to the nearest level. This is called quantization error. As we have lower and lower bit depths, we are forced to round up or down more and more because we have less and less levels to work with. When we look at our original wave and we look at the waveform we get from quantizing, we can see that the wave is still smooth, but it's different. So what does this quantization error sound like? It doesn't sound like stair-stepping or aliasing or anything like that. For various reasons, and again, I urge you to check out those resources in the description of this video, this difference due to bit depth just sounds like plain old noise underneath our original signal. So that answers our second question. A higher bit depth means less quantization noise. So rather than just tell you this, let me show you how this works in practice. So I have this beautiful piano piece by Chris Zabriskie opened up in Adobe Audition. And you can find a link to this music track in the description of this video. This is a 32-bit floating point music file. So if we have a listen, it sounds very nice. It's a very good song. It sounds like this. Now let's see what happens when we take this music file and convert it to a 4-bit music file. And I would turn your speakers down for this, because it could get messy. So we'll convert this to 4 bits. And as you can see, immediately the waveform becomes something more like a stair-stepped waveform. But when we actually listen to this music, you will see that the end result doesn't quite sound the same way. So even though that does sound terrible, if you listen closely, you can still hear the underlying piano track. All we have now is a lot of additional quantization noise. So let's go back and see what happens if we convert this file to an 8-bit music file. As you can see here, immediately the waveform looks more or less like the 32-bit original waveform. And if we listen to the music, this is what it sounds like. So as you can hear, by increasing the bit depth, we've reduced the quantization noise, but we haven't done anything like increasing detail resolution or anything like that. Now let's hear what happens when we go up to a 16-bit file. So once we're at 16 bits, you can tell that it is now very hard to hear the quantization noise. Again, by increasing the bit depth, we have not increased detail resolution, we've just reduced the amount of underlying quantization noise. So we have our bits and we have our noise. What this means is that an audio file's bit depth determines the minimum noise floor of the recording, and therefore it determines what is the maximum dynamic range of the recording, since any noise softer than the noise floor will be masked by the quantization noise. So again, this answers our second question. A higher bit depth means that you have a higher dynamic range. With a greater bit depth, you can have a bigger difference between the loudest and softest sound, because you have more room above the quantization noise floor. The human ear has a dynamic range of roughly 140 decibels. This is the difference between a pin dropping and a jet engine. A 16-bit recording has a maximum dynamic range of 96 decibels, but thanks to a technique called dithering, 16-bit audio has a perceived dynamic range of something closer to 120 decibels. Again, I'll refer you to the ziff.org video for an explanation of dithering. Now, 24-bit audio gives us a maximum dynamic range of 144 decibels. That sounds great, you might say. What's the problem with more dynamic range? Well, when we return to our audio file, we can get a clue. When we have a file at 16-bit, it's actually very hard for us to hear the quantization noise, unless we turn up the volume very high. Why is this? Because as you are sitting here watching this video, there is probably noise from your computer, noise from the outside, noise from the train, noise from the air conditioning, noise from the DAC and the amplifier in your equipment. So in a 16-bit recording, in order to hear the quietest noise in the recording, you would need to play at a volume where the loudest noise is at least 96 decibels higher than the quietest noise. This means that if you are in a library with a 30 decibel noise floor, the loudest noise in the music would need to be at the volume of a jackhammer. And this means that if you are in a library with the 24-bit recording, in order to hear the softest noise in the recording, the loudest noise in the recording would need to be at the volume of a rocket launch. It's actually speculated that listening to music this loud might not just destroy your hearing, it might send you into a coma or kill you. Obviously, you are not going to listen that loud, so the end result is that no matter how much bit depth you have, you cannot overcome environmental noise unless you listen to music in a soundproof room. 16-bit audio was chosen as the standard because audio engineers thought that 96 decibels of dynamic range or 120 decibels of dynamic range with dithering would be more than enough for anyone who wasn't listening to music in space. And most recordings these days only have about 24 decibels of dynamic range to begin with. Good classical recordings might have a dynamic range of just over 60 decibels. So 24-bit audio with a dynamic range of 144 decibels for music files is a pointless waste of time. sold by audio companies on the myth that bit depth corresponds with the resolution of an audio file. It is a waste of hard drive space and a waste of money. So why does 24-bit audio even exist? Because for musicians, when they are producing music in the studio, 24-bit means that they can mess around with the levels of their tracks and have room to move without introducing more noise when they increase the gain. That's why musicians use it, and that's why it's become an industry buzzword. When the CD is mastered and you are listening with your headphones, 24-bit audio is pointless unless you are listening to music in a vacuum. So next time someone tells you that they can hear the difference between 24-bit audio and 16-bit audio, ask them if they do their music listening in space. Or better yet, share this video with them, and hopefully we can move the industry into focusing on things that actually make a difference. Click the like button if you found this video helpful, and please share it with your audiophile friends. Check out the links in the description of this video. I am very, very grateful to the original authors for helping me understand this quite complex area. I'm looking forward to your comments, and as always, happy listening.